Hello everyone, my name is Sunil Huang and I'm continue on my lecture on Buddhism and Buddhist practice at Dongguk International Summer School year 2019. From the previous video, I started to talk about karma and samsara, the rebirth and the action. So the previous video, I just talk about the people who enter into the India, call themselves Aryan, and how they settle down inside of India, and they move from the Punjab Indus River Valley area to Ganges River Valley area, where they met the forest. That's the Aranyaka. So in the Aranyaka, the idea of rebirth was not really conceptualized, and the idea of rebirth starting to appear not in Aranyaka but in Upanishad. So today I will show you my lecture on the formation of the idea of samsara appeared in early Upanishad. And then the last one, Upanishad. Do you know the meaning of Upanishad?
Sitting cross.
Sitting cross. Sitting near. Maybe sitting near. So when we said to anyone, come very close to me, we'd like to say something very important. I will tell you my bank number. I will tell you my secret phone number. You know, something like that. So Upanishad means they'd like to hand over some kind of a very essence of our life, essence of world, essence of the God. They'd like to say to someone very important. So usually, who they call to come near and talk about it? Father said to their son, you come very close to me and I'll give you the secret of the world, and they hand over the knowledge. That's the Upanishad. So Upanishad is more like a philosophical text. Very nice to read. And in Aranyaka and Upanishad, we can see two types of rebirth theory. One, I put it here, accidental rebirth, 우연적인 윤회. The other one, inevitable rebirth, 필연적인 윤회. I just put it there. So I explain these two types very briefly. Inevitableness. Two types. I think this is an intermediate state. This is almost a complete state. So this is intermediate, and this is a completed one. And the both story, you can see two of the oldest Upanishad in Indian text. One was called Chandogya Upanishad, and the other one, Brhadaranyaka Upanishad. These two texts, one of the oldest Upanishad in Aryan produce, around the same time with the Buddha, I have to say. In both texts, we can see. And first one, I really like this accidental rebirth story. In the first one, we have a king called the Jaivali. So Upanishad is just like a narrative, just like a story. It's very easy to read through. It's almost like very interesting story, I have to say. We have a king, Jaivali, in this story, together with the Svetaketu, young Brahmin. And his father, Gautama. We have three person here. Sweta Ketu is a son of a Brahmin Gautama. And the Brahmin Gautama said to his son, come very closer, and he educated him. He handed over the knowledge, Brahman should have. So when Sweta Ketu become the age, usually age of 16, usually have Upanayana Sanskara. Upanayana Sanskara means twice born. First born, just a physical body. Second born, reborn with the knowledge to become the proper Brahman. So Upanayana Sanskara means Sweta Ketu become proper Brahmin at the age of 16. So the father said to his son, oh, my son, you become the real Brahmin. So from now on, you are independent. So Sweta Ketu become very happy. So he go out to the countryside, and then somehow, accidentally, met with the King Jaivali. And the King Jaivali is an elderly king, but very bright, a nice king. And Sweta Ketu, very young and not tamed. So in India, when you met someone, title is very important. Title is very important. Do you know any formal title for the king or queen or prince? Anybody know? 우리 언제 불러야 되겠습니까?
Excellency.
Your Excellency. Your Excellency, we use it, ambassador usually become Your Excellency. But princess, we usually have a HRH, Her Royal Highness, Princess Sirin. in UK, England, when they have a ship, Her Majesty ship, Queen Elizabeth II, something like that. So here, title is very important. So if I didn't put HRH, it's very rude, very naughty. So similarly, Sweta Ketu is a young bride, and Sweta Ketu met the King Jaivali. So he should think about the title, king, proper title, he should think about that. But Sweta Ketu, when he met the king, Sweta Ketu said, Buho. In Sanskrit, Buho means sub. It's not the title for the king. If someone is a king, if someone is a religious leader, we should call them Bhagawa. So the Buddha's title, Bhagawa, blessed one. So this is a formal title to the king. But Sweta Ketu, newly become Brahmin, become very self-confidence. And so he just said, Buho. Buho means the sunsengnim, and so on. It's very rude. So the king become very upset. So the king asked a question to the Sweta Ketu by saying, have you finished your study with your father? And Sweta Ketu, yes, I finished. I'm fully equipped Brahmin. You can ask any question, I can answer. Then the king said, okay, I'm going to give you 5 questions. If you answer it, I will accept you as a formal Brahmin. And Sweta Ketu said, yes, because he finished his study. And then the king give a question about rebirth. First one, do you know where the person go when they die? Do you know why a dying person going up to the sky? Do you know why the other world keep people going there, but not the pool of living creatures? And so on. This kind of pipe question, just give it open from King Jaivali to Sweta Ketu. Sweta Ketu cannot answer. So he became very embarrassed. And he just hide away, hide away. So he coming back to the house, to his father, said to his father that, father, you said, I finished my study. But today the king asked me five questions, I can't answer. But Gautama is very nice Brahmin. Gautama asked about it to his son, what's the question? And the question was about rebirth. And Gautama said, my son, I don't know the answer. I think we should go to the King Jaivali and learn about it. So Gautama actually go to the king for the knowledge of rebirth. So this is very peculiar, because usually in India, knowledge belongs to Brahmin, and Kshatriya pay the money for that. But in this case, knowledge belongs to Kshatriya, and the Brahmin approaching there to learn. So it's not the normal case, you should remember. So it actually suggests, the knowledge of rebirth doesn't belong to Sanskrit-speaking people. It's indigenous people in India. So they go there to learn. So in your handout, I put it there. The king said to Gautama, as to what you have asked me, Gautama, let me tell you that before you, this knowledge had never reached the Brahmins. Gautama야, 내가 네가 질문한 거에 대해서 말해주겠는데, 당신 이전에 이 지혜, 윤회에 대한 지혜는 결코 브라만들에게 전해지지 않았다. So this sentence also clearly show knowledge of rebirth doesn't belong to Aryans who come in India from outside. And the answer, very strange. You know, when people die, what we do? Cremation, 화장, 화장. When people die, we do cremation. When we cremation, the person become pyre. And then this pyre going up to the sky, and to the moon, and sometime there, and then become water. With a cloud coming back to the human world and going into the diet, maybe rice, and then man eat it, and then from man to woman, and then we be born again. So it actually show how when we die, how we coming back. They just explain. But this, what do you think about it? When I was a second year undergraduate student, I did this, and I thought, Indian people full of imagination. How can we believe this kind of thing? You know, I was actually you know, not really believed that. But when I went to Varanasi in India, I changed my mind. Varanasi, when you go there, it's a riverside. It's a riverside. In India, Ganges River is like a god, and Varanasi is a holy of the holy because two river just meet together, and there is a Varanasi. And usually, river stream from lower is very dark, and the river stream from the north very clean because water coming directly from Himalaya mountain. So clean water meet with the dusty water, and then clean water when you check very very carefully, it can purify the water there, and the purify the water. Going down to the Varanasi area. So Hindu people believe this purified water can purify our sin in the life. So according to Hindus, if we did something very bad, it was like a dust attached to our body. So what we should do? Clean it in the holy water. So Indian people go to the Varanasi, usually have a bath there, because this is a holy water, and they clean the water. With that clean the water, we can cure our past wrong action. That's for sure. So this bigger site, when you go there, you can see people selling everything. But in the middle of Varanasi, we have an automatic cremation facility. Because in Varanasi, there are many homeless people, usually elderly people. When they die, civil servant took the body and through this automatic cremation facility, they cremated, remaining going into the water. So the water in Varanasi area smells very bad because there are so many body cremated and the remains of body just go there. It smells like, what is it? Dried skin? Ojima? Ojima? Ojima goes themselves. Sometimes, poorly cooked pork belly smell, something like that. Smell very bad. But actually, when I first went there, I was a second year undergraduate student. I did the diving there. No problem. Once I go in, I drink a bit, but I'm okay. Because of that, because of this purifying power, Varanasi is the best place for cremation. Anybody die near Varanasi, their body goes to the riverside, have a cremation, and the remains going to the river, then they will be reborn as a god, they will be reborn as a human being, and so on. They usually believe it. So there are many people who are there, Hindus, as a pilgrim. They did a pilgrimage, clean the body. And usually when they're going back, have a water together with them, and when they go back there, they put water into the statue of God Shiva, statue of Vishnu or Shiva Linga, they usually do. this is the traditional cremation site where you can see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. When I was there in 1991, it was okay. I can take a photo and everything. But nowadays, Indian people become very sensitive. Tourists approaching there, take photo, they usually crush your camera, so you should be very careful. You can see there are many cremation sites. It's very, very nice. It's a firewood, you can see there. And how they do that? Build up firewood and put the body there, and Brahmin coming with a fire, and then he have a 5 times circumambulating. Why 5 times? Human body consists of earth, water, fire, wind, and ether. So usually have a 5 times and then put the fire. So 1991, I was very lucky. I was a backpacker, and the backpacker usually sleeping in the train. So 3 days sleeping in train or dormitory, and then 1 day in hotel, and drink some beer and have a shower, something like that. So Varanasi, when I arrived there, it's a hotel. So in India, if you'd like to drink beer, you can't get it from supermarket. It's from off-license. Off-license usually located near the railway station. So as soon as I arrive in Varanasi, I directly go to the off-license. I order 3 beer, bottle of the beer, Kingfisher. Anyone who go to India, you should drink Kingfisher, red label. It's very strong, 6 to 8% in alcohol, but very nice, excellent beer. So I order 3 bottles, and the 1 bottle I just drink it in front of the place. And the second one open it, third one they wrap it with the newspaper. So I have 1 bottle here, the other bottle here drinking, and go to the riverside. And when I go there with that, some people just let me go in. So I thought, Indian people so kind. They led me to watching cremation from start to the end. So I talk about this experience to my colleague in Delhi University, and he said to me that you had a beer. In India, young men drinking beer is like untouchable. They don't want to touch. You have no future. That is why they let you come close to them. So that night, I was very lucky to see it. Very close, not just across, maybe 5 meters, 3 meters, 5 meters, I was sitting there and watching the cremation from start to the end. I can't forget. Maybe I will die with this memory, I have to say. So I was sitting there drinking beer and watching the cremation. And what was happening was very interesting. Around 1 hour, so roughly, the body was moving. Why do you think the body was moving? I feel like, oh, he's still alive. Because our belly is heated up, and explodes. So it's something like that. And then around 2 hours or 3 hours later, there is a big explosion. So what was it? No, our head heated, and it exploded. And when this one explodes, it's like a Hollywood movie. Some kind of fire is moving, something like that. So I was drinking, sitting there, and 3 or 4 hours later, when there's an explosion, something was going out. Fire was going out from the body, and this fire is going up. And that night was a Pullman night, and I saw that something is going out from the body, and this is going up to the sky. So that exactly is the description we can see. These accidental rebirths, when people die, we did the cremation. The person becomes smoke going into the night, to the sky, and so on. So actually, this accidental rebirth is the outcome of their observing, observance of cremation. Brahmins drink soma just like alcohol, so they are. And they feel like, oh, dead person going up to the sky, something like that. But this is not perfect. Why not perfect? Stopping of rebirth means nirvana. It's a self liberating. But what if we coming down at the top of Everest mountain? What if we coming down in the middle of Sahara Desert? There is no possibility to become a plant, no possibility to become eaten by human beings. So that's the end of rebirth. So even though it looks somehow when people die, how they coming back, but not perfect. So I have to say this is an intermediate stage.
I think I should stop here because this is the intermediate level of establishing the idea of rebirth and karma. And you can see here in this story, you can't see any idea of karma. You can't see any idea of Atman, the indestructible soul, which become the subject of endless rebirth. Somehow this story explain how, when we die, how are we coming back to the human world. That's clearly explained here based on their observation on cremation, I think. Today I stop here, and the next video I will talk about the real Indian systematized version of rebirth and karma. Thank you very much.